Log Talk Radio.
He is the last of his kind. All that remains of a once powerful nation. Some think he is a myth. Some believe he is the chosen one, who will bring balance to a world at war. And some will stop at nothing to destroy him.
Welcome, 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 Moors. The Moors Talk Live 100. I'm your host, Tarhaka Amana L. Bay. And tonight, we're going to deal with the shooting of our people in the streets. My special guest tonight is Brother Irritated Genie. He will be our guest tonight. And I want to start off by saying, if there are any policemen listening to this show, you are welcome to dial into the broadcast. The number to dial is 310-982-4184. Press 1 on your phone if you have something to say. We hope you do, and that's all you got to do. Okay, tonight we're going to be dealing with the following questions. Is it wrong for our people to defend themselves in the streets by any means necessary? When approached by a man with a gun in the street, should we be to kill that man? When a man shoots at another man, should the man who was shot at shoot back? When a man kills your child, should you kill that man? When a man beats your woman down in the street, should you find that man and beat him down? Should a man be shot in the back for running from another man? Is there any excuse for any policeman to not know the law? What is the first law of nature? These are some of the questions that we're going to be dealing with. All right, my illustrious brother, I can see he's already in the chat room. I want to start out by saying tomorrow night, the Grand National Chairman of the Moorish Government, we're going to be dealing with what did the prophet say about these days that we're experiencing right now with all this shooting and stuff across the country. So make sure you tune in tomorrow night right here at Moorish Talk Live 100 on Blog Talk Radio, okay? Also, on the 31st of this month, myself and Dr. Walter Williams, including his wife, in a roundtable discussion on racism in America and the history of racism in the world. Don't miss that powerful broadcast. That'll be July the 31st, Sunday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, okay? All right. Now, let's deal with these commercials. Once we get this out of the way, then we're going to go directly into the broadcast. So y'all hold on for a second, and we will be right back, okay?
One more time. Our foreclosure killer package not only comes along with the necessary documents that you'll need, but also your very own personal coach to walk you through the process of saving your home. If you've been foreclosed on already, or if you've received documents stating that you'll be foreclosed on, or if you're already in the court fighting a foreclosure, contact Tarhaka Amana L. Bay, 904-303-9061. Also visit our website at www.newdebtelimination.com. stop foreclosure on your property. Let's stop this unlawful practice. Contact me, 904-303-9061, before 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Peace.
Okay, everybody, listen up. It will be 2016 in spring, but before your new year begins, it's time to solve your debt problems. To be burdened down with debt is no way to start a new year in real time. In spring, call me, Tarhaka, 904-303-9061, before 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's 904-303-9061, before 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Or go to my website at www.newdebtelimination.com. That's www.newdebtelimination.com. Start your new year off right. Peace.
At 10. He was on the ground, hands in the air, no weapons. But he was still shot.
I'm asking the officer, I said, sir, please don't shoot me. Please do not shoot me.
Tonight, anger and confusion after a disabled man's caretaker is hit by an officer's bullet. His story from the hospital on just one station.
Hello again, everyone. The man can be heard in the video insisting he is not armed, but an officer opened fire.
Now the department is under fire, and the Night Team's Alex DeProda was live for us outside North Miami PD with an exclusive interview with that victim. Alex.
Well, Craig, in that exclusive interview from this man's hospital bed, the behavior therapist says he complied with all officers' demands, put his hands up in the air, but he was shot anyway.
Charles Kinsey laid in the middle of the road on his back, his hands in the air. North Miami police aim their rifles at him. Listen as he yells to the officers he is a therapist and was trying to help a confused autistic man who wandered away from a group home. Kinsey says he complied with the officer's demands.
When I went to the ground, I'm going to the ground just like this here with my hands up. And I'm laying down here just like this. And I'm telling him again, sir, there's no need for a firearm. I'm unarmed. He's an autistic guy. He had a toy truck in his hand.
Police were called to the area by someone who claimed there was a man with a gun. Kinsey says there was no gun, just his client holding a toy truck, which was clearly visible to the officers.
Anato, please. I'm really more worried about him than myself. Because I'm looking at, as long as I got my hands up, they're not going to shoot me. This is what I'm thinking. They're not going to shoot me. Wow, was I wrong?
Wrong, because Kinsey was then shot in the leg. It wasn't caught on camera, but he says he had his hands up the entire time.
But when he hit me, I'm like, I still got my hands in the air. I said, no, I just got shot. And I'm standing there, I'm like, sir, why did you shoot me? And his words to me, he said, I don't know.
Kinsey says the officers rushed him, patted him down, found there was no weapon, and then handcuffed him.
They flipped me over, and I'm face down in the ground with cuffs on, waiting on the rescue squad to come. I say about 20 minutes took the rescue squad to get there.
And
I was
bleeding.
Yes, bleeding. I mean, bleeding. And I was like, wow.
7 News was there as Kinsey was taken to Jackson Memorial Hospital. The Circle of Brotherhood, a group that aims to solve problems in the community, and Kinsey is a member of, protested outside the North Miami police station Wednesday. Kinsey's lawyer is outraged.
There's no justification for shooting an unarmed person who's talking to you and telling you that they don't have a gun and that they're a mental health counselor.
Kinsey wants a full investigation and wants to know why the officer fired.
My life flashed right in front of me. You know what I mean? Because when he hit me, my first thing I'm thinking about my family.
Well, we asked North Miami Police Department for a comment after we first aired some of this cell phone video at 6 o'clock. They have not responded, but earlier in the day, in a written statement, they said the state attorney is investigating. We're live in North Miami tonight. I'm Alex DiPrato, 7 News, 19.
Okay, we back, Mose. That just happened yesterday. The man laying on his back, got his hands in the air. He's talking to police. He's explaining to them what's going on. Don't shoot this mentally unstable individual that's sitting up with a toy truck in his hand. I'm not armed. My hands in the air. I'm laying on the ground, and you shot me anyway while I'm talking to you. Okay? All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we ready to begin the broadcast. I see that my guests have dialed in, and I'm going to open up his line. Area code 202, Brother Irritated Genius, are you with me, man?
I'm with you loud and clear, my brother. How you doing?
Hey, I'm doing fine, man. I'm glad to have you on here, brother. And it's a privilege to have you on the broadcast, and I'm pretty sure that if there's anybody I can depend on to weigh in on this thing, it'll have to be you. But before we get started, could you tell everybody, because we got some new people on here, we want to tell them about yourself and what you got going and where you're at and what you think is necessary for them to know. You have the floor.
Absolutely. Well, the Irritated Genius Southeast of an organization called War on the Horizon. We have a program. We actually have three programs that come on 7 to 10 p.m. Each week. Monday night is my program, the War on the Horizon program. That's Straight Black Pride Radio on Blog Talk. Then on Tuesday nights, we have E.J. Jones with Straight Black News, ex-NFL football player. And then Thursday nights, like we have tonight, we have Sister Tasha and Brother Tad doing Straight Black Talk from New York City. Also, have a website, warontthehorizon.com, where you can go and read it. And basically what we're doing is preparing African people for survival in the 21st century, pretty much along the lines of what we're seeing now. And lastly, we have this weekend, we're having an event this Sunday. ISUPK, Hebrew Israelites, and the Straight Black Pride Movement, of which I'm also a part of, a movement that's pushing black family resurrection for the 21st century. We're coming together in New York at the Alhambra Ballroom, 3 p.m. in Harlem, New York, this weekend. You can go to warontthehorizon.com to see the website, and you can see the flyer. And basically, we're doing a lecture and a discussion and an organizing effort to stop child sexual abuse in the black community. So we got a lot of things going on in terms of African survival in the 21st century. And we hope that people can tune in and find out more about us.
Okay, fantastic. Now, brother, what's going on, man? What? How do you see this thing?
Basically, I think it was about 2010 when the Trayvon Martin thing happened. I'm not sure when George Zimmerman murdered this young
right.
man. He actually uh-huh. called the police, and the police told them not to pursue this young man. And
mm-hmm.
he went, he shot the young man, killed him. And then when the police came to the scene, and even the whites that saw what happened were giving their testimony, they said when he was on top of the young man's chest and he was about to shoot him, and then the police said, "You mean when the young man was on top of his chest?" And they said, "No, when he was on top of the young man's chest." And then they said, "You mean when he was on top of their chest?" And so the police basically coaxed the people into changing the testimony and ultimately
uh-huh.
had a trial with a European judge, a white
uh-huh.
female, who said the word race cannot be used in this trial.
Wow.
Had a trial where if you look at it, and I'm using this to get into what's really going on, but I just want to set the picture. It was so
okay.
deep because I talked to a big-time attorney, and what they said was that even the prosecutor threw the entire trial, because one of the main things you want when you want to find someone guilty is you want to cross-examine the person, because
okay.
then you'll be able to show that they did this with intent. You'll be able to catch them in every lie that they tell, and you will be able to get them to convict themselves, essentially.
Okay.
But what the prosecutor did, which no intelligent prosecutor would ever do, is that the prosecution allowed Zimmerman to give his defense by video and present the video in the courtroom.
Okay.
When he did that, in doing that, he was not able to be cross-examined. I'm only bringing that up to the point that it was not only the defense attorney and the judge that participated in getting them off and the police, but the prosecuting attorney, the prosecuting attorney was just as responsible for participating in the murder and the and expulsion or the not guilty verdict of George Zimmerman after the murder of our young brother Trayvon Martin. We saw a whole system of terrorism organized and worked perfectly with the assistance of some Uncle Tom Negroes, with the assistance of the police, the white murderer, the small hat white so-called Jew named Zimmerman. We saw a system in place of killing black people, and it being made public. It was almost as if it was an announcement for we're coming in to really step up the genocidal assault of African people, and we want you to accept it and see it so that our people would get comfortable with it.
Okay.
Now, there are a lot of different things going on, but one of the things is that the white so-called Jews see that these white Anglo-Saxons are getting armed in this country.
Okay.
And they don't want them armed because they want to continue to run this society, and these Anglos are sick and tired of the Zionist control of this country. So these white folks take the weapons from the Anglo-Saxons, which is not going to very likely happen without a fight. But they also want to enlist us in the process of fighting these Anglo-Saxons. At the same time, they want to be able to kill our people and to lead our people into unrest to justify more government violence against black people. So it's a lot of different things going on. But on the basic level, they created an atmosphere where whites, who I'm going to say whites who are a terrorist group who've infiltrated the police force,
okay,
really just terrorists, which means they have a police uniform and they look like a police officer, but they're not really doing the job of a police, which is to serve and protect. They're really going around and saying, the first opportunity I get to murder a black man, woman, or child, I'm going to do it.
Okay.
And they've been given the okay by everything that's going on in society to do it, and by getting these not guilty verdicts, and they've been going around and systematically doing this. And what has happened, they finally gotten to the point where they pushed the button, and some of these young brothers who have gone and got military training, who have been fighting in the war against terror, they were over there fighting other folks called the war against terror, and they learned about what a terrorist looked like, and they were taught to identify, isolate, and exterminate terrorists. Now these brothers are coming back, they're gaining some culture, they're learning knowledge and stuff about their own people, and they're watching the same type of terrorist things that they were taught to deal with in the military happening to their own people. And so they're saying, look, we got our brother Micah Xavier Johnson, we got our brother Cosmo Setevan Ra, peace be upon both of those ancestors, and these brothers are saying, look, I've been trained to kill terrorists. And so they're seeing terrorists who happen to have police uniforms doing it, and they're killing them, and they're giving motivation to other black people to say, you know what, we don't actually have to die like this. I mean, we can't bring the brothers and sisters who died back, but we can certainly have a response for it, particularly since it is clear-cut cases of domestic terrorism that are going on. We have an obligation as the men in our community to protect our community. And since this country has taken a strict policy on terror, there's no negotiating with terrorists, there's no talking with terrorists, they've actually created the pretext for black people to collectively say, you know what? Do I feel afraid when I go outside and get in my car? Yes. Why? Because I don't know if this individual's police car is a terrorist that wants to kill black people or if they're just a regular police officer doing their job. But because I've seen terrorists in police uniforms killing black people, and the police haven't arrested them, the police haven't done anything about it, it makes it very difficult, if not impossible, to make a differentiation between the police and the terrorists that are wearing police uniforms. Hence, if we were smart and wise, this will begin the process of black men creating our own description of what we have to do to protect our community that will give us our own authority to defend our community in whatever manner we see is necessary. And right now, it's becoming more and more necessary to be more and more actively, physically engaged in direct conflict with individuals who are trying to kill black people in our community, because they are really creating terrorism. And if we don't have people like Micah Xavier Johnson, a young 25-year-old brother, who unfortunately lost his life, but before he did, he took some lives with him. And the same with our brother Cosmos Atemra, 29-year-old brother. Neither of them ever had children. It's a shame that they had to go through this process to protect our community, and that the older brothers, we didn't do this. But if we don't have people doing what these brothers are doing, then our people become so afraid that we become like some of the small hats of white so-called Jews who would walk into these gas chambers. Because we're so afraid to do anything about it, we forget that we have options to resist. These brothers are reminding us that we should resist, and they're creating an environment where if black people have to leave our homes and feel terrorized as, oh, my God, am I going to make it home tonight? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, there's some terrorists who are in police uniforms, or if there's a social thing, some people say some of these are good police. Well, the good police are now nervous that somebody might mistake them for a terrorist and pull the trigger on them. So maybe they should get the same kind of sleepless nights that we have, and we'll see how the environment changes. But I'm very, very happy that someone, particularly these two brothers, has taken a definitive stance against terrorism and murder of black people in our community. And it is a pretext for the rest of us as black men to really come together and say, okay, enough is enough. There, you know, and it all depends on how people look at it. Some people say, well, you can never fight a war against the police. Well, black people wouldn't be declaring any war on the police. That would be crazy. However, we're in America, and America has expressed a war on terrorism, which means as American citizens, we have a right to fight terrorism. And if we see any group engaged in terrorist acts against black people, as American citizens, we're not only legally have the authority, but we're actually charged with the responsibility, since it is evident that the police don't have any means to ascertain which of these individuals is really terrorist and which is not, that we would have to make those decisions on our own, and we would have to exterminate the terrorists. So that would be something that we really have to consider, because it's the perfect climate for such a thing, since we're in the war on terror, and since the whole pretext and tagline of the country is we're going to stop terror, I don't think there's anyone that would have seen what happened, any black person, that would have seen what happened in Louisiana and Baton Rouge to our brother Sterling, or to our brother Philando in Minnesota, and to the sister who was in the car with her and the baby in the back. I don't think anyone in their African mind, right black mind, would have said that that wasn't terrorism. Everybody would agree that's terrorism. I mean, you have this young woman, she can't even hold the chest of her man and try to stop him from dying as he's dying right there, because this guy wants to shoot and kill her with a four-year-old child in the back. These individuals are being given incentives to kill black people, because if you kill a black person and you shoot somebody in line of duty, you get so many months off. You can retire early with extra benefits. So there's a benefit to killing our people. And now with Brother Micah Xavier Johnson and Cosmos Atepera and their great work, now they also consequences, because when a terrorist in a police uniform commits an act of terrorism against black people and is recorded and black people see it, what they're doing is not only creating terror in the black community, but they're creating a pretext for somebody black to say, I've got to stop terrorism, that could result in the death of some terrorists in police uniforms, or perhaps maybe even an innocent police officer who was mistaken as a terrorist. So now, innocent police officers now have to take responsibility to deal with the terrorists in blue, because they might get them killed. Your act of terrorism against a black person may result in some black person thinking I'm a terrorist, blowing my goddamn brains out, shooting me and my family in the car, coming to my house and kicking in the door. And because black men are behaving in this way, and due to resisting terror, now everybody feels the same feeling and the same threat. And that's what I think is the direction that things are headed. Now, I'm not certain, but if what we've seen in the last few weeks is any indication, there are young people Not the ones running around using the N-word, grabbing their crotch, screaming and yelling, talking a bunch of foolishness. But we're talking about real men, young men, who are willing to take lives, even if it means giving their own life, in the defense of the black community. Many of them have been trained in the very armed forces that taught them how to identify, isolate, and exterminate terrorists. And they're beginning the process of doing that. And I think the black community would do well to do some cleansing, not just with individuals who've infiltrated our law enforcement and our terrorists, but we may have terrorist cells in our own community molesting children. We may have people that are doing all kinds of things that threaten the survival of African people, and we may need to take a stronger, I call it a Black Panther Plus. You know, during the 1960s, the Black Panthers took a certain stance. Now we're facing genocide as a race in 2016. The next organized move of black people, we may not be burning buildings. You know what I'm saying? We might be burning, but it might not be buildings no more. We might not be looking for hurting nobody's property. We may be very, very serious about saying, you know, our lives are very important. And they're so important that if you threaten our lives and take our lives, we're going to show you how good we are at taking other people's lives. And I'm not advocating, but it looks to me like that's the direction things are headed. And to me, it makes me feel good because I no longer go to sleep at night feeling like depressed about the murder. Yes, I'm angry about the murder of our brothers and sisters. But what I know is that those are not happening in vain, that we have people that are saying terrorism of the black community is going to stop. And I think that it is a line that we, a tagline we need to start taking. We need to stop identifying these as police officers. The ones that are committing these acts of murder, I'm not talking about the questionable cases, but when we see innocent people just being mowed down and shot, like the video clip you just played, there's nothing else that can be described as. It's not a police overstepping their bounds, which would be maybe pushing you when they shouldn't push you, or saying something disrespectful or something, or you know, just something beyond their police duty. This is not a police duty to kill black people. That is not a police duty. That's terrorism. It is going into a community and making a group of people who you've identified and you have hatred or venom towards feel threatened by your presence and feel as though they're not safe in their own skin. And doing their day-to-day life. And that's what's happening to black people. But we're having people that are striking back on our behalf, and I think that we should not ever forget to remember them, say their names, and encourage our people to respect these men. In fact, I think any sister that's listening, if you have a child that's on the way, a young son, and you haven't decided what his name should be, I think you may be considering the name Micah or Cosmo, maybe the name Setepenra. You know, we need to start remembering our warriors, because we're not going to produce any warriors if we don't show our children. I showed my children today and did a little video and got them to praise our brother Micah Xavier Johnson, and got them to praise Brother Cosmo Setepenra, praise the killers. They're killing in the name of defending the African community. We have to love them. We have to praise them. Our children have to look up to them. And dunking a basketball is cool, but Michael Jordan doesn't even – they don't know who Michael Jordan is, my children. But they know who Cosmo Setepenra is. My children don't know who Magic Johnson is, or what's his name, LeBron James. They don't know him yet, but they definitely know the name Micah Johnson. And that's the kind of tagline we got to be on for African survival and dealing with this terrorism that we're facing right now in America.
Okay, my brother, you couldn't have said it, no better. And I'm in 100% agreement with you. Because what has not happened yet, we have not looked at this particular species of people that are doing the shooting and started an all-out assault on them and their families and them and their children. This has not happened yet. However, I'm in full agreement with you that we should be we should hail our heroes. I mean, it should not be frowned upon. When we have people like General Patton and Douglas MacArthur, these men were killers. And not only were they rewarded, but monuments were erected in their honor.
But when you start saying, well, we should create a statue or a monument to Nat Turner, when we talk about creating a statue, a monument to Michael Johnson and the other brothers, and all of our John Horse and all of our great men that have stood up and done things that they were forced to do. This is something that we got to do. We have to acknowledge these things. We're going to have to, because, see, anytime war has been declared on you, you're going to need to recognize that war has been declared. And this is something that we have made every attempt to ignore for years and years and years as a people inside the United States. We cannot ignore it. I've used everything that I could in preparation for this broadcast tonight. The photographs speak for themselves on the platform there. And we're also going to be doing a follow-up video on this broadcast, so we'll put it out there on YouTube. Now, I want to ask you, I see I got another brother with his hand raised, or someone with a hand raised. I'm going to open up this line and see what it is and see what we got here. Area code 772, you're on the air, 772. You have a question or comment for our guest? Probably just accidentally mashed the button. Okay? All right, let's get back. All right, now, as I was saying, there's another serious issue that we're going to have to confront today, brother. And this is something we need to take a very, very serious look at. Because in my opinion, the most dangerous man in a situation like this is what's commonly referred to as a house nigger. And I hate to use that word, but in this situation like this, because this is a serious situation that we got going on, and it's going on across the United States. And I commend my brothers and sisters that came from other parts of the United States and came to Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and I commend you, I honor you. That was great. Love for our people has to transcend our own personal families. We got to realize that we are all we got. I can see we were immigrants on the land. We're not. We're native. We know there's been a whole lot of lies told. All black people on the land came here as slaves from Africa, totally overlooking the fact that we had over 130,000 free Moors on the land prior to any European ever coming here. So all of these truths and stuff got to be brought out, but one of the main focuses that I try to get people to understand is to totally understand where you are and what you are supposed to do now beyond any means necessary, and to look at the origin and the true record of what you are dealing with. What is the record of this particular man? What has he done on the earth in the past? What has he done in the present? What will he no doubt do in the future if you don't do anything about it? So this is what we have to look at, and it's very, very important. A lot of people say, well, we don't need to look at slavery, and we got this, we got that, and the other. But I want to ask you the question, brother. What is the first law of nature?
Self-preservation.
Is it wrong,
yes,
for a man to shoot another man in the back when that man is running away, in your opinion?
I would have to say that depends.
Depends on what?
I mean, it depends on why you shoot him in the back. If some European touch my child, or anybody molest my child and they running, I'm going to shoot him in the back. I'm going to catch him. I don't care. You know? So it depends on the circumstances.
Okay, the reason I ask that question is because I sit and watch an incident where a man got out of his car and he was running from a policeman, and the policeman shot him in the back. But the law states that if a man, if you have an altercation with a man and the man is running away from you, you are not to shoot that man. Now, that's what the law says.
And that's two different things. You asked the question, is it wrong to shoot a man in the back? Well, if you just talk about a regular situation, you have to know the circumstance. And that situation, man, we know it's wrong because the rules that they have say that they're not supposed to do it. So it's not even disputable. This is a system that says, here's the circumstance. When you're in this circumstance, you cannot do this. And they did that. So then it's clearly definitively wrong in that circumstance. There's even no question about it. Well, and so, well, go ahead.
Go ahead. I'm listening.
No, that's fine. I'm answering that question. In that case, it's absolutely wrong.
Okay. Well, we got another serious situation. See, what we have here in the United States, and I keep trying to get people to understand that, there is a difference between legal and lawful. What we have is we have what's called the highest court in the land, the United States Supreme Court. That's the law of the land. But we have individual municipalities, we have cities, states, and counties that are leading the people to believe that they can force law, which is not law, private public policy masquerading as law, and enforce this against the rules and regulations of the United States Supreme Court. In other words, the United States Supreme Court has ruled over and over and over and over again that you have the right to travel. Speeding is not a ticketable or an arrestable offense. That's a right you were born with. But we have public policy inside the municipalities, counties, states, and cities that says you need somebody's permission to exercise a right that you were born with. And at the same time, we got policemen who are actually under the impression, out on the streets and cars with guns and badges, under the impression that they are actually officers of the law. But officers of the law are elected officials, and there's usually only one, and that is the sheriff. So the rest of these guys are private contractors. They have a hazard bond. They have to be insured. But they are not being taught law, let alone the basic rules and regulations and guidelines of an individual's human rights. So we have a very, very terrible situation going on here.
This is the thing, in my personal opinion, I don't think that that is going to have any impact. One thing I've learned about Europeans, you can write down stuff, you can teach them stuff. At the end of the day, what they respect is pain. And the more pain you bring to them, and the more willing to bring pain to them that they know that you are, the more better they respond. I don't care what you write on some paper. I don't care what. If there are no consequences for their actions, if they're not fearing for their life, their family life, their friend's life, and all that, you can read as many laws and statutes. The statute that means most of them, if they know that if they go outside tomorrow, there's going to be somebody waiting out there to seek justice, that's going to get their behavior a little bit better. Anything short of that, I mean, if they don't have consequences, there is no law for them. They are the law. Racism, white supremacy says to the European mind, I can do as I choose until they're met by equal and opposite or stronger force. And the force that they was met with was Cosmos Tetevenra. Right now, I'm telling you right now, all of the years of legal battles and all this stuff down in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, right now, you got two groups of officers in Baton Rouge. One group of them is sitting around going, man, we're going to go out here and kill some black people because they're so angry at what happened. But they was already saying that before that. That's why they killed the brother Sterling. Then you got another group. The other group is saying, I'm scared because I don't want to get shot today. And they're going out and they're being as nice as they can to people because they're going, I don't want this thing to pick up and somebody else to take this example and start doing more of this. So I'm going to be cautious. Mm-hmm. Now, at some point, it becomes a situation depending on, you know, how it goes. Because what we have to do, honestly, if we continue after these two, basically, I would say these are warnings where young men gave their lives and took lives in the process. These are warnings that we as black men we'll arm ourselves and defend our community, and if you try to exterminate us, we'll exterminate you. That's what I heard them say. Now, I'm not saying that's what they said, but that's what it sounds like to me. As far as I'm concerned, based upon that warning, two things are going to happen. The police are going to start slowing down in this overt murder of our people. But like the thing you showed today, I'm going to be honest. They shot him, but he didn't kill him. In my opinion, the environment that is being created by the terrorists who've invaded the police force and are killing black people got him to shoot him. But the reason he shot him once and didn't start putting holes in his chest, because the environment created by Brother Setepan Ra and Brother Johnson made him say, there's a hesitation there. What's going to happen is they're either going to continue doing this, and then black men are going to say, there's been a declaration of war against our community, and so we have to go defend it, and that means we're at war now, which means all the rules go out. There's no law in war. You don't determine the law until you win the war, and whoever wins says what the law was and who did the illegal stuff. So it's like they're either going to make that decision to declare war on the black community, in which case you got, I think you probably have 100,000 police officers in this country, and you probably have about 15,000, 20,000 black men. And so it'll be 20 million against 100,000, and we'll see who wins. I hope it doesn't come to that, but when you look at it with those type of numbers, I don't see how the police would do too well, particularly since they can't identify which black men are willing to take lives, but it's a little easier to identify most of them because they wear the same uniforms. So the terrorists are wearing a uniform that puts all the police in danger. And if all the police want to take the hit for the terrorists, then that would be horrible, but I don't think they can win either battle, in my personal opinion. I think it would be a bad decision for them, but it looks like they'll either go to where they'll slow down or there'll be an engagement. And it'll be engagement where we say, okay, since you have thrown all law out of the window, and I'm not talking about the terrorists that are killing black people, we know they're terrorists, but I'm saying the police officers who don't arrest these terrorists when they kill black people, they are responsible for throwing law out the window. When Eric Garner was choked to death by these officers, by these terrorists in police uniforms, it was clearly acts of terrorism. There was no reason for them to kill that man. Mm-hmm. When the police did not arrest those, they were responsible for defending and supporting terrorism. As police officers, they saw a murder occur. They were supposed to arrest those officers. Because they didn't, they are responsible for aiding and abetting in murder. They're accomplices to murder.
Correct.
And because they went to court and were found exonerated, then that means there's a system in place to support the murder and terrorism of black people in our community, which means there's a system we have to consider. But the front line of that system are the individuals who are actively murdering black people, who have infiltrated the police force and are wearing police uniforms but are really terrorists. Within that understanding, if they continue this process, I think it will push black men into a corner where we will have to say, my God, this is an all-out war against our community, against our children, our women, our families. We have no choice but to defend ourselves. And then all law goes out of the window. It's just a matter when we get off work and the lights go down tonight, let's get out here, let's do this. You know, it just becomes a situation where we say, look, we're just going to go and see who can take it more. Who can stand the pressure? Who can stand the pressure the most? Because, you know, as African people, we've been under pressure for like 400 or 500 years. I don't know how much pressure they get. You know, I mean, I'm not saying we're going to win, but I'm saying we've been taking a lot of pressure for hundreds of years. Our whole life is pressure. I don't know if they can stand this kind of pressure where everywhere they drive, any given moment, anybody roll up to them and just start letting off with no mercy, no resolve, just any given time, any moment. You never know when it's going to happen. You don't know who it's going to be. You don't know which direction it's coming from. You don't know who you're going to pull over and they're ready to go. You don't know who's trying to entice you to pull them over. Because as I said, you just don't know when somebody's ready to just blow your brains out, just kill you or murder you in the most vicious and direct. You just don't know. It would be a terrible thing to happen. But I think that they're pushing black men in that direction. And I think if they push black men in that direction, I think it will be bad, because you got a lot of brothers who are not doing nothing with their lives and are just wasting away smoking weed and doing nothing, but who would find some inspiration in a war where they could be perceived as heroes by defending their women and children in their community and actively engaging, and quite frankly, A lot of them just have animosity towards police for being arrested or abused in the past. And I think a lot of people could find new life and new meaning in their life in the process of bringing justice to our community. I don't know if they want to open that door. But if they do open that door, I don't think that this war would last long. Because 10 million against 100,000, it doesn't seem like the odds are good. Because you got to remember, there are black men who are ex-military. There are black men who are ex-police. There are black law enforcement officers who are black. They just happen to have a job as law enforcement, and they don't like these white boys any better than the rest of us. And you got all kinds of brothers that have been trained, can't get jobs, been put out the military or whatever case, or were in the military, and they still got post-traumatic stress disorder. But they black, and their mother is black, and their family is black, and their children are black, and they can see this is being one of their children murdered like that. And if this thing happens and the police unlock this door, I don't think they'll last a week. I mean, once black men got a rhythm of saying, we're just going to go out here and defend our community, reckless abandon, there's nobody getting locked up because you can't lock all of us up because we just coming. We just going to bring it to your doorstep. We just going to – ain't no debating, ain't no what the rules are, what the law books say. You ain't going to get a chance to read no books. Ain't going to be no witnesses. Ain't nobody to talk about nothing. If black men start taking that type of personality, which I don't advocate, and I hope it doesn't come to that, but if they do, then we'll see how much pressure they can stand. I don't think they can stand that kind of pressure. I'm not sure. I don't think they can stand it.
Okay. All right. Well, I like also say that if you want to weigh in on this conversation with my guest, the number to dial into the broadcast is 310-982-4184. Press 1 on your phone. That'll give me an indication that you got something to say, and I'll open up the line. I heard one of the most interesting things coming out the mouth of a so-called black police captain. And, I mean, in my opinion, this guy is amazing, man, and I want to run this little quick clip, and let me know what you think about this, Jeannie. Hold on a minute.
Yes, sir.
Welcome to the Advise Show, Media with a Common Sense Approach. So Sheriff David Clark, a sheriff that a lot of conservatives like, especially the conservatives that love Fox News Channel, they have him on there all the time. Well, the sheriff, the good sheriff, he's made some statements that was very strange to me, that stated there's no police brutality in America or racism within police departments. We're going to roll the clip.
Sheriff, to weigh in. Sheriff, your reaction to some of the sentiment you heard on the streets on Saturday.
Well, it's just crazy talk. That's ignorance in its purest form. You know, I think we need to rethink the strategy. I don't know why the police even bother policing those demonstrations. They're not protests. Those people advocate for the overthrow of our legally constituted government. What
the president
I would do
says they have
is
a point,
let them
Sheriff.
Fend for them. Let them fend for themselves. Let the good law-abiding people of New York clash with them for disrupting their lives, disrupting their businesses. Then the police can show up and arrest these subhuman creeps for creating a disturbance. That we can do.
Go ahead.
Well, first of all, there is no police brutality in America. We ended that back in the 60s, so I don't know where they're coming from. You look at the data and the research, and there's a new Harvard study out that shows that there is no racism in the hearts of police officers. They go about their daily duty, if you will, to keep communities safe. The President of the United States knows better. He's playing the race game. He's playing race politics. Shame on him. He's been very divisive for this country. He has been a nightmare, and I cannot wait until January of 2017 so that America's nightmare can be over.
Yes, the sheriff said everything that you heard. He stated that police brutality ended in the 60s. So we'll put some of that up on the screen. So he said that unless you have that Bull Connor police brutality, then, hey, it's not going on today. Sheriff, The only thing that's not really going on today is them calling out the fire department to spray down black people with fire hydrant water hoses. Now, according to the good sheriff, he states there are no police brutality. It haven't been that way since the 60s. So let's go put up some of that on the screen. Now, sheriff, you said it has stopped after the images that we were watching now. But sheriff, maybe you're right. Maybe something's wrong with us. You know, when we watch certain videos, it's not police brutality. It is, I'm in fear of my life, so I can do something to you. And then, hey, it's not police brutality. I was just in fear of my life. Or maybe is it you didn't comply. So whatever they do to you, it's just because you didn't comply. So in the sheriff's mind, because you didn't possibly comply in 1.3 seconds, and because the cop says he's in fear of his life, so if you're black, that puts you in a category pretty quick, then I guess there is no police brutality according to the sheriff. But the rest of us who are looking at these cases, who are looking at these videos, I think we see otherwise. And you say there's no racism in police departments. We have done stories where there have been straight-up racism in police departments. So what, you don't research anything? Listen, you got access to people at Fox News. Why don't you research it? Oh, wait a minute. They're not going to research those cases. It don't matter what they do. They're not going to put those stories up or even talk about those stories. My bad. So I can't expect you to ask your friends at Fox News to do that. But why don't you do some independent research, Sheriff? Hit me up in the comments, use the commentaries, subscribe.
All right, Jenny, what you think, man?
The term
no police brutality in America.
The term ethnic cleansing comes to mind.
Mm-hmm.
There are certain black people, or people with black skin, who are so vulgar. We call them Mobutus. We don't use the N-word. We call them Mobutus because there's an individual named Mobutu who actually killed Patrice Lumumba in the Congo.
Uh-huh.
And he was a rabbit. He was a rabid dog for European interests, and he was so vile that he destroyed a revolution that had occurred in the Congo, and really that nation is one of the most suffering nations in Africa to this day because of his racial treason. One of the things that we have failed to do as a race people is deal adequately with our race traitors.
Uh-huh.
This individual, along with Jesse Lee Peterson, are two of the most overt, obvious, easily identified race traitors amongst our people. And there are many more. But to be perfectly honest, in the process, and maybe even before the process, of a full engagement with other races in terms of our interests, competing with their interests in the 21st century, one of the first things we're going to have to do is identify, isolate, and adequately compensate the race traitors of our race, not those that we disagree with, their philosophy, but the individuals who are so racially committed to white authority and abuse of black people that they will go out in front of whites to defend white interests. If we do not deal with them adequately, we will never get to even address the races that are causing problems for our people. And this, what I just heard there, was one of those individuals. And like I said, the term ethnic cleansing, meaning we're a race of people, African people, and we have some individuals who are not fit to be part of our race. And so we have to decide what we're going to do with them, do it efficiently and effectively so that we can get on with moving forward with uplifting our people in the 21st century.
Okay, we got another caller with the hand raised at area code 904, and I'm going to open up the line. Area code 904, what's your question or comment for your guest?
Hello?
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 What's your question?
Hey, I am so just proud of you, y'all guys, as being black men, and the world is awakening. And I see it with my own eyes. Like, We don't have to tolerate. We tolerate too much. We've been tolerating, and I never thought I would. Yeah, I thought maybe my kids would see it, because I taught my kids to be aware of everything that's going on in your surroundings. I never thought I'd see the day that we're gonna get there. It's gonna take some time though, and we gotta realize, okay, we've been dealing with white folks for so long, and we've come accustomed to what they do and everything. And we have to realize, like, if we come together, like, I don't care who you are, what you do, if we come together, if all black people would come together, we'd be awesome. That's all I have to say. Be very awesome. Religion-wise, a way of living. I don't live by religion. This is how I wake up in the morning. I live how I live, and I know it's a good way of living. But we just got to just, like, lay all the bullshit aside and just come together. It's happening, though. It's happening. And I'm willing to die. I'm a female, and I'm really willing to die to keep my nation strong.
I hear you, sister.
Well, look, and I appreciate that, sister. And let me say this, and I'm not putting this responsibility on you. I'm saying this more for the men. But I do want to change the course. First of all, thank you for the warm spirit and the call. But I want to change I want to change the spirit of the dialogue. They killing us anyway. So being willing to die for something is not really that important right now. We need people that are willing to kill for stuff. And I'm not putting that responsibility on you. I'm just saying the course of the dialogue is being led by those who are taking the front lines. And what our young brothers have said, they weren't willing to die. Their lives had to be taken from them. But what they were willing to do is go out there and say, enemies, beware. If you try to do harm to my people, I'll blow your damn brains out. And so we need to start talking with a different language. Not, will I be willing to die, because we're dying anyway. We don't want no more black folks. If that happens, there's something they got to take. Now, I'm not willing to die. They have to get that result. However, we are willing to fight. And we are willing to resist no matter what the cost. So that's all I would say to that, and I really appreciate your spirit, sister, and your strength.
Okay, I'm muted the mic because the giant phone was breaking up there.
Okay.
Brother Jeannie, now, what I want to ask you now is, because I've seen, and I look at different levels of things, and I have never lost sight of the system that is in place, the global system of Caucasian supremacy, the economics, education, entertainment, labor law, politics, religion, sex, and war, as laid out by Neely Fuller and Dr. Francis Quest Wilson, and the underlying factors in knowing that each one of these points have to be dealt with. But I look at the different levels, and when I see the situation where this cop, Caucasian man, looked to be about 240, straddling a sister on an open highway, beating her with a closed fist, that told me that it has reached the level now. There is no, you know, there's no more respect. And if we don't do something, we won't survive as a people. And for me, that did it. That let me know exactly where we are. I was been around a lot of men all my life, and that is the reason why the questions that was that I listed was put there that way. I didn't say a police officer. I said, when a man kills your child, should you kill that man? Because this is the way that the men spoke to me when we dealt with these kind of issues. When a man beats your woman down in the street, should you find that man and beat him down? Should a man be shot in the back for running away from another man? Is there any excuse for any policeman not to know the law? These are direct questions and stuff that I deal with as a child, because I was received a great deal of information from these men
And the majority of these men came out of Vietnam. I don't know nothing about no Desert Storm training. These men here are quite different. And I think a lot of what I saw them do and what I learned from them, I really don't think, I think some of that stuff was obsolete in Desert Storm. I don't even think, man, it was so awesome. But anyway, I'm not going to get down into all of that. But I want you to, in your opinion, if you can, because I made up a little list of what I think might be some solutions. What, in your opinion, do you think would be some solutions that we can could use or concentrate on in order to effect some change?
Now, effect some change in regard to police,
to the people and
the
police. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I, you know, for years, I've actually done some interviews where I've said this, and I wouldn't be surprised if the people who did those put these interviews out soon, because, you know, I don't give the general tagline. I don't talk about police brutality very often, because the reality of it is we got some things to get done in our house before we can actually deal with this. The only way to deal with a gang is to have a bigger, stronger, meaner gang, period. There's no way to dismantle a gang unless you have a more powerful gang. So if you look at all the gangs that were shut down in different cities around the country, they were shut down by a bigger gang, which is called law enforcement, or they were eaten by another gang. Or the gang called, you know, America put in jobs and things of that nature to break down that system. But you fight gangs with gangs. So the only way to, and I'm not talking about in the interim, you know, getting our attorneys involved, getting brave attorneys that'll take this thing and all that. Really, though, the ultimate conclusion to police brutality is going to be when black men come together and say, we're going to make this stop. We are a race, there's a gang, and those terrorists that are terrorizing our community are a gang, and they're terrorists. And we're going to get rid of this problem. Ain't no debating it. Ain't no long. So it's got to be very, very public and open. This is going to stop. Mm-hmm. We're going to make it stop. And we got to put aside all law. We have to create our own law. The African law is that black people will not continue to be terrorized. We're going to go deal with the terrorists. We don't want to hear no debates about it. It's not no negotiating with nobody. It's nothing to talk about. When the lights go out tonight, we're getting it cracking. And we got to make sure that we got to win. It's just that simple. We got to make them know we ain't even waiting for you to do nothing. You done enough. This ain't it. This is going to stop permanently. And we got to bring it to them so that they know there's no room for any adjustment. We literally have to give it to them to the point where they say, you know what we're going to do? We're going to readjust the whole structure of what we call the police force. It's literally going to be, If you have a problem and you're bleeding or something like that, then we can come there and take you to the hospital. But there will be no terrorist hunting of black men, women, and children going on. That has to end. It's got to be a situation where that it's just not possible to do that because of what you'll unleash on yourself. And it won't take that long. It just, when we decide to do it, we got to be ready to do it for real. And we got to understand, hey, in this process of dealing with terrorism, you lose people. When the whites went over to these different countries and they decided they were going to deal with terrorism, they knew that they were going to lose people. And they lost thousands, if not tens of thousands, of people. But they, quote-unquote, fought terrorism. Well, we got to do the same thing. We got to fight terrorism. And we have to look at it from a different perspective. Sometimes we draw the war in such a way that we can't win. We can't look at it as if we're fighting white folks. No, we're not fighting white folks. White folks got a right to do whatever they're doing, at least for the time being. No, we're not fighting law enforcement either, because that would be illegal. We're not doing anything with law enforcement. There are terrorists that are killing black people, and the ones that we've identified are here. They've infiltrated law enforcement, and the terrorists have to die because they are terrorists. Again, this is U.S. policy. And we have to enforce that policy very, very definitively, without question or without regard to, there's no law that can prevent you from fighting terrorism. Now, remember, When the U.S. went out and made these laws against terror, there was no law that they had that said they could go and fight these wars. They said these wars are being done because terrorism exists. Then they made a Patriot Act. Hey, if terror, if you're in terror and terrorism is occurring, you have to throw aside all law and abandon it, and you have to go to war to prevent terrorism. Well, that's what we're facing, domestic terrorism from terrorists who've infiltrated this force, and it's going to be up to us because they can't, obviously they can't do it. They haven't been arresting these guys. These guys are murdering and executing black people and walking around like everything's okay, and everybody witnessed it. So it's not like I'm making up something or saying anything that's illegal. Everybody saw open executions and murders of black people occur, and these individuals weren't even arrested. So with that being the case, you can't fix a problem like that with anything else. We can talk about the economics, and that's great, and the boycotts, and that's great too. All of these things are great. But ultimately, when we get serious, there's only one way to deal with a gang, and that's to make that gang fear your gang. And we're going to have to make ourselves, our community, a gang. This is no terrorism. So that decent policing, they'll come around there and feel very comfortable because they'll know, hey, these are people who care about their community and we can ride through safely. But if there's a terrorist amongst us, we better root them out before they do.
Okay. Now I got another caller with his hand raised. I'm going to open up the line. Keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, now it's time to weigh in on this conversation. The number to dial is 310-982-4184. Press 1 on your phone. That'll give me an indication you got something to say and open up your line. Area code 772. What's your question or comment for our guest? 772, you're on the air. Okay. No 772. All right. Going on down to the next thing. Now, what did you think about this, Jeannie? Across the United States, we don't have any communities. We got neighborhoods. What do you think about all so-called black precincts in large, predominantly black communities? Fully staffed with nobody in there but us. That look like us. All the policemen look like us. They're interacting with the people. It ain't all this about the police, but our people. What do you think about that across the United States?
I'm going to be honest with you. The problem with that is that unless we pick the individuals who are homegrown from that community to be in that police force, what we would end up with is individuals like that mayor of Minnesota. I mean, a sheriff of Minnesota. Mm-hmm. See, whites would literally go around and handpick the most vitriolly hateful, sadistic, anti-black, black-skinned males and females they could find. The people who have been brutalized by our own community and have venomous, visceral hatred for black people, put them in our community, and it would get worse than it is now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying that I don't like the idea. If we, let's say you and I got to pick the young bloods that would be trained to protect our community and stuff, it would be fantastic because they would be from the community. So when they was coming around, people would be telling them what's going on because they know this person. This person would be putting over brothers that's drinking and saying, look, you going to stay right here. I ain't letting you go into this. How your mother been doing? Good. I ain't taking you in, but you ain't going nowhere until you get sobered up. Man, I got a party to go. You ain't going nowhere. You going to sit here for 2 hours. And, you know, so it would be a situation where it would be care and love and concern because we would be picking the strong, decent, just individuals from our community to do it. So we would love these people who was coming around to keeping us, and we would respect them. But the reality, if the whites got that as a mandate, they say, yeah, we'll put some black folks in there, and they have a process of identifying Mobutus and race traitors and self-hating Negroes. They would identify them, put them in our communities, and the murder and the brutality would increase. And, let me just add one more brief, and they would pick the violent homosexuals and give them badges and stuff, and then you would have police officers raping dudes. I mean, it's just, I know it sounds like I'm conspiracy theory, but I'm not. I've seen them do this kind of thing. So I know how they operate. It only thing that's going to work is for us to make it clear, it doesn't matter what you look like. If you come in here with, you know, with some mess, it's just going to be a problem. It just doesn't work that way.
But I'll take a look at
but it's a good idea. It's a good idea if we could control it, but I don't think we can control it.
Well, the reason I brought it up, because right here in Jacksonville, where I am, that's actually what we had back in the 60s, because we had apartment complex, huge apartment complex down here, and they had to put a black police precinct there. And the only people that worked out of there looked like us. And them was a real good, solid brother. And it brought it all down. We didn't have any Caucasians working out of there. And, of course, that was back in the time when, you know, racism was at its peak and we were not allowed to do this and we couldn't do that and all that. But
now,
I thought back to those days and what. Hmm?
Can I intercede something here?
Yeah.
All right, now let me be a little bit more clear, because I left a piece out. Let's say that we create the kind of atmosphere where they know that this terrorism is not going to be tolerated, and they fear for their safety just because we're so hostile towards terrorism and we can't identify the terrorists from them. In an instance like that, where they begin to say, well, what can we negotiate? Then if we're in a position of power to say, we don't want nobody around here except for the black officers, and we want to determine who they are. In that case, like they have in a lot of places in the South right now, like you go to Mississippi and some of those little towns, they ain't got nothing but brothers in there, solid brothers and sisters, and they protect their community. So it does exist, but in order for it to happen on a national level, it's only a threat that's going to make that happen. It would never happen due to them trying to do the right thing. We would have to make them have to do that, and the only way to make them have to do that is to say our gang is bigger than yours. But to your point, if we were in a position of power to make it happen, I think it would be phenomenal.
Okay, I got you. And I think you're right. I'm going to take one more look at my brother man again, the one that said there's no racism in America. Let's see how he did. I checked him out again, and I had to collect some of his stuff. Because, boy, he was a mess. So let's take a little quick break, because we're down going into the second hour. So I'll take you a little quick break, get you some water. I'm going to put him on.
Three officers dead, three wounded in Baton Rouge. A really tough day for Baton Rouge and for the country, really. Here to talk about how to keep our police safe is Sheriff David Clark of Milwaukee County, Wisconsin. He is going to be speaking at the Republican convention tomorrow night. Sheriff, thank you very much for that horrific day. I spoke to the heads of the sheriff department, the police department, and the state police down there, and they told us how their hearts were reeling. Their message is peace and coming together in the country. What's your message?
You don't believe that for 1 minute, do you?
That their message is?
Yeah.
That's what they said to me.
Okay.
Yeah, believe them.
Any protests over the deaths of these cops today in Baton Rouge?
I don't know that.
Any riots or protests over the police officers in Dallas, Texas?
What are you asking?
It's a pretty simple question.
I asked you if what's your message to the people. Their message is one of peace. What is your message?
My message has been clear from day one, 2 years ago. This anti-cop sentiment from this hateful ideology called Black Lives Matter has fueled this rage against the American police officer. I predicted this 2 years ago. So Do I want to know?
With all due respect, do you know that this was because of that?
Do we? Yes,
know
I do.
As a law enforcement officer?
I've been watching this for 2 years. I predicted this. This anti-police rhetoric sweeping the country has turned out some hateful things inside of people that are now playing themselves out on the American police officer. I want to know, with all of the black-on-black violence in the United States of America, by the way, when the tragedies happened in Louisiana and Minnesota, do you know that 21 black people were murdered across the United States?
Black officer who was killed today, but let's...
Sheriff,
please, let's just keep the volume down here. So I understand,
three dead cops this week,
Sheriff,
and I'm looking at five last year. You trying to tell me to keep it down?
Please, if you'll just please, we can keep it civil. Because the message to people at home, I'm sure you want, is one of civility.
I wish, Don, I wish you had that message of civility.
I would like to have a conversation with you.
Toward this hateful ideology, these purveyors of hate.
You don't know what my message is.
That's
what
they do.
What I want to say to you is,
these people preach vile and virtue in the name of hate.
We're going to go to break, and we'll be right back. All I want to do is have a conversation. I can't have a conversation with you if we're both talking at the same time. What it sounds like to me is that you're accusing me of violence and supporting something, a narrative that I'm not necessarily in support of. And if that's what you're accusing me of violence, then you can leave. That's not true. I don't support violence of any type against police officers, against anyone. So if you're accusing me of that, then you're welcome to leave. But if you want to have a conversation, I am more than willing to welcome a conversation with you. I don't disagree with you about there is a narrative across the country that could be harming police officers. But we don't know right now, as someone who's in law enforcement, if that was the actual cause of it. Go ahead.
Let me ask you this. Do we know that generally the American law enforcement officers are racist? Do we know this?
Go on.
I ask a question.
Do I know American general law enforcement are racist? I don't think anyone is accusing. If you're insinuating that people are accusing or saying that law enforcement across this country as a whole are racist, then your assumption is wrong.
First of all, this whole anti-police rhetoric is based on a lie. There is no data, and you know this. There is no data. There is no research that proves any of that nonsense. None.
You'd have to be more specific about what data and what nonsense we're talking about.
That law enforcement officers treat black males different than white males in policing in these urban
centers.
There
is data that supports.
There is not data.
The president spoke about it. Cedric Alexander, who is a law enforcement officer.
The president has been lying about it. He said it again the other day when he said black males are 2 times more likely to be shot by a law enforcement officer than white male. Don, that is a lie.
That is not a lie.
It is a lie.
Yes.
Show me the research that we have
from the Washington Post that
the Washington Post debunked that nonsense.
There's also research.
He also said
Sheriff,
this, Don.
There's also research.
He continues.
A Harvard professor that also showed that black people are treated more aggressively by police officers.
No, you are wrong in your interpretation of that Harvard study, because I read the study. That's not what he said. He said he was surprised to find
that in shootings of the most severe in shootings that he found no evidence that there was a difference. Also, it should be noted that study was a very small sampling of police departments across the country. Many people did not find it credible, but it is also interesting that in that research, he found that blacks were treated differently when it came to aggressive policing, but for the most egregious shootings, he found no difference. That's what that study showed.
Well, based on what? Just generally? Are we talking about high crime areas? Are we talking about police officers being under attack? Because let's go back to where this whole thing started in Ferguson, Missouri. The lie was hands up, don't shoot.
Lumping a whole bunch of things into one. If we can do one specific thing,
that's where this whole phony movement started. It started out as hands up, don't shoot.
You're talking about Black Lives Matter.
Right.
Okay. So if you would need to speak to someone who is a member of Black Lives Matter about whether they have perpetrated a fraud on the American people. That's up to Black Lives Matter. That's not me. I'm neither a member of Black Lives Matter, I'm neither a supporter or someone who doesn't support them. I simply report on Black Lives Matter.
Do you condemn the anti-police rhetoric coming from this hateful ideology?
As a journalist sitting here on television, I don't have to condemn anyone, anything. That is something that
Other people
around the country,
I condemn
their jobs to condemn
them. Just like I condemn the hateful ideology out of groups like the KKK. All right? I condemn it. There is no place in American discourse for that sort of vile, vitriolic hate coming out of this ideology. This has fueled and fanned the flames of this anger toward the American police officer. There's only one group in America, one time, that truly cares about the lives of black people in these urban ghettos. And it's the American police officer who goes down there on a daily basis, puts their life on the line to protect who? Black people. So when you say we just want to have
to
a conversation,
put their lives on the line to affect,
let's
to protect
have a conversation
people.
About the black-on-black crime, which kills more black males, which is more of a threat to any black male in the United States than a law enforcement officer.
Sure. Yes, that's a different conversation. We can walk and chew gum at the same time. There's an issue when it comes to violence. Black on black crime, or black, it's crime. White people kill white people, tend to kill white people.
You know,
black people tend
not
to kill black people.
Not in the numbers. Not in the numbers.
That's fine, but that's a different
conversation. I don't care who white
that
people are killing.
That is a different conversation than police brutality. And we're not having that conversation right now.
What
and
police,
again, I want to be very clear with
you.
I condemn all violence of any type, just for the record.
Was the situation between Mike Brown and Darren Wilson, was that police brutality?
But we're not talking about Mike Brown and Darren Wilson.
I am.
No, if you're asking me what the Justice Department showed, the Justice Department showed that it exonerated Officer Darren Wilson, and that the hands-up, don't-shoot narrative was a false narrative. That has been reported by
CNN
and by others.
And that was another phony report.
What does
that
have to
debunked.
Do with Baton Rouge, Louisiana?
All right, because when you take in rates of involvement in violent crime, and crime in general, but violent crime, you're going to see that black males are overrepresented.
Yeah.
Overrepresented.
Yeah.
In terms of being involved in violent crime. That's going to mean more arrests. That's going to mean more people going to prison. This stuff has already been debunked.
Sure. That's a different conversation.
Every
one
time,
that many people
every
don't,
time
none that
you
many,
don't have a response to something I
it's
say,
not
you
that,
say
it's
a
not that
conversation.
I don't have a response to you. Is that we're having two different conversations. I'm talking about, I'm asking the questions here. You're answering the questions by asking questions about some other subject that we're not discussing.
We're talking
that is
about
not a
this
conversation.
Hateful ideology called Black Lives Matter. You said you're not a member. You can't be a member. It's not
that's,
an organization.
That's
you have no structure.
That's what you're talking about.
It is an ideology.
I understand it's a very stressful time for you.
These individuals. These individuals.
And Sheriff, we appreciate you coming on.
They preach
thank you.
Vile and vitriol in the name of virtue.
Yeah, thank you, Sheriff. We appreciate it.
Okay, we back, Jeannie. what we gonna do with him, man?
I mean, you know, he again, like I said, this guy, Jesse Lee Peterson. Strong, I keep calling him Weak Arm Williams, Armstrong Williams. There's so many of us, a lot of females too. I'm drawing a blank on some of their names now. These individuals are black skinned individuals who
mm-hmm.
have no interest in the preservation of our race whatsoever. He's married to a white female. He has no interest, and he's willing to do the bidding of white supremacy and kill black people on behalf of whites. We just have to identify these individuals. We have to identify them. Then we have to isolate them. We have to make every black person that sees them recognize them a certain way. And they have to be so shunned in our community that they're not considered black, that their ability to do harm to us is negated substantially and significantly by the fact that all black people shun them and put them in a position where they don't even benefit the whites. Because when we see them, we start screaming racism because why are the whites putting this kind of dog in front of us? So that it backfires on them because sending him only would serve to get us much more angry and be more resistant to whatever they're trying to push than anything else. So that's pretty much that. I don't spend a lot of time on these kind of guys because, again, you know, if you're trying to get in a dude's house and he got guard dogs, and that's what these people are. They just guard dogs. They don't have their own minds. They just bark for their master. There's only two ways to get past the guard. They don't follow rules. You either poison them or you shoot them. And the only way you get in the house. You know what I'm saying?
Man, I heard that since 1967. Dude told me that. He said, boy, look at him. I heard that since 1967, man. But you absolutely correct. But the reason why I'm putting this out here, because I knew they exist. And I mean, I've been seeing them all my life. I recognized them a long time ago during the riot back down here in this city when we had this. And I learned a long time ago because I was taught by the brothers. They were like, hey, man, a coward to get you killed. And the worst thing on the face of this planet is a joker who looks like you. But he black on the outside, but he white on the inside. You better watch him because he's dangerous. That's a dangerous joker there. And so I've been peeping, but then it's gotten to the point where they're coming out. Like I was listening to the guy in Dallas, the chief of police in Dallas, and he's the same way. They don't kill his own son, and he's still hiding back. Dallas is hurting, and the lives of these officers. My heart goes out to them. I be like, well, when is your heart gonna go out for anybody that look like you? And then I hear, see, this guy, he'll pop up over here. This is amazing. And I mean, you ain't heard nothing yet. I got one more. And you got to hear this right here, especially it is short and it's right down to the end. I want you to, because it was unbelievable when I heard him say it. I couldn't believe he said out of his mouth what he said. So I'm going to take a little quick break, and when we come back, we'll continue, brother, okay?
Yep. All right.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back in a minute, so y'all hold on here.
Sheriff David Clark, who says, try no standard. Sheriff, what do you think of this?
Well, it's pretty obvious, Neil. This is something that plays itself out in American cities darn near every day of the year. And the inconvenient truth here is that too often disparately, as a matter of fact, the perpetrators are young black males. That's the discussion that we should be having in this country instead of papering it over with things like targeting the police and cop bashing, which the President of the United States, Eric Holder, Al Sharpton, and their cabal are doing right now, so that they don't have to really deal with the real issue in this country as it relates to crime and is the disproportionate involvement by young black males.
You mentioned just what I was going to follow up with, Sheriff, that you'll hear those on the left say, and those who organize these nationwide protests say, yeah, but it happens a lot more to black males at the hands of white police. What are the real facts here? You educate me here.
Well, you know, Neil, that's a lie. And I want to give Fox News credit for flushing out the truth here. You look at the statistics, and the numbers don't lie. All right, and that's that inconvenient truth that I'm talking about. That's a little more difficult for, you know, the cop bashers and those promoting this, you know, these false narratives about hands up, don't shoot, and Black Lives Matter. You know, that's easier to peddle, I think. But if we really want to talk about something in America, it's we have to talk about the violence and who the perpetrators are. And like I said, it's very inconvenient for a lot of people that it happens to be at the hands of young black males. So we have to look at the behavior. We have to look at why they're in these situations to begin with. No care whatsoever for their fellow man. Obviously, the crime is committed not only for hate, but it's also committed for profit. And so until we address these things and really make the, I call it the drive-by media, Fox notwithstanding, confront this ugly truth and talk about it and really start a dialogue that we need to have, then they'll continue to use these very isolated incidents of police use of force and try to make it seem like that's the problem in America. The police are not what's wrong in America. The police are one of the few things left that's right about America.
Where the hammer comes in.
You know, though, far more worrisome to me, and we haven't even mentioned some of these almost jihadist-type incidents in this country, Sheriff, where you know, this white teenager who was killed in New Jersey, you know, that was more than a hate crime. That almost was like a jihadist act. But that should be a concern to all races and all media. And yet those type of incidents have increasingly picked up a pace. But we don't hear as much about that. I mean, you're trying to do your job. You're trying to be fair to all races, to all people you serve. But that part has got to bug you.
Well, yeah, you know, Neil, I don't view everything through the prism of race like some people want to do. I think it's very destructive. I think it's counterproductive because I look at this, all these things as crimes against humanity, period. I think it transcends race. I think the people who are out there propagating and peddling this false narrative about police use of force, they know that. But as long as they can get people's attention on that, it helps them not have to confront the reality in this country about crime in general and the disproportionate involvement of it by young black males.
You are in a community where young black males look up to you, though, and talk about it, and they no doubt tell you this and say, Sheriff, this keeps happening to us, and we don't like it, and either they buy Al Sharpton's lines or some of these others. What do you tell them, Sheriff?
Well, first of all, it's about the behavior, and I embrace the role model. Role modeling, I should say, that I play here in Milwaukee County, Wisconsin. And if you just reason with individuals, especially, you know, our young people, and present them with the facts, most of the time you see the look on their face and they're shocked that, well, I haven't heard that, and where did you get that from? And as long as you confront them with the truth, all right, eventually, against that false narrative, and that is an uphill climb against that false narrative, but as long as you just continue to talk about things like personal responsibility, things like self-discipline, things like self-motivation, things like self-actualization and self-determination, and encourage these individuals, okay, we know that the odds are stacked against you, but the biggest thing that you can do for yourself is learn how to overcome obstacles. I've had a lot of success peddling that narrative here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, but it's been against this real strong force of propaganda, of false narratives about race in America. Look, we all know that race is an explosive issue in America. But I'll tell you one thing that I think is going to start happening soon, Neil, and that is that white society is going to get tired of having their nose rubbed in the past sins of slavery. We know what it did. We know what happened to this country. But white society has made great strides in trying to right that wrong. That's another narrative that's not being peddled here. And it's one that I'm willing to give white society credit for. I think I'm living testament to the fact that this country has changed. I mean, like, it's like night and day, and the opportunities are there for everyone. Everyone's included now, and any sort of racism or discrimination has to go underground. It's episodic. It is not institutional in the United States anymore.
Sheriff, it's always a pleasure. If for no other reason than calming us down and stepping way back to have you. Thank you again.
All right, Mo. There you have it. What do you think, Jenny?
Well, you know, he said something that's very, 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 very interesting. He said that he's a testament to how much things have changed since slavery. I would say it the exact opposite. During chattel slavery in this country, they had a position on the plantation called the overseer.
That's correct.
And many times, these overseers were actually black.
That's right.
And their job was to break the spirit of any of the black people who wanted to resist the abuse of slavery.
That's correct.
He is a modern-day version of the personality of the overseer. That the whites give power to brutalize and otherwise maintain a system of enslavement of black people. And if you know anything about the rebellions that occurred in the South, one of the first people they had to kill to get free from bondage was the overseer, particularly the black overseers, because the black overseers were, generally speaking, more enthusiastic about the enslavement and the brutality of black people than their white slave masters. I'm going to say that again. Generally speaking, the black overseer was more enthusiastic about the brutality and enslavement and abuse of African people on the plantation than even their white slave master. And he represents a shining example that not much has changed since that time. He is a modern-day overseer.
And they are all over the United States. I got a couple of incidences I want to tell you about that I was fortunate enough to witness. I had a job working for a little part-time job at night, you know, a little four-hour job, working, running a buffer machine inside this building that had these offices. And one night I was in there and I was buffing the floor, and I kept hearing a voice. And when I cut off the machine and I listened, because I know I heard somebody, and I wasn't accustomed to anybody being up on that floor at that time of night, because it would be like 11 o'clock at night, you know, I was in there. And so I heard his voice, so I started walking between the cubicles to see where the voice was coming from. And I got in this one cubicle, and I heard this this white guy, and he was talking, and he was just holding a regular conversation. And I hadn't went in there in that cubicle yet, because I was going to vacuum that floor also after I did the little hallway. But when I bent the corner, there was a brother on the phone behind the cubicle. And I told him, I said, wow, I said, Cuban brother, I said, I thought you were Caucasian. And he looked at me, and he had this big grin on his face, and he was like, thank you. You know, and I said, thank you. I turned around and walked in there. I said, man, I can't believe you. Man, this is unbelievable. This was one of the most remarkable. That thing stayed stuck in my mind until today. And then we had another situation where I was working for this real exclusive club. Well, all you little super rich, wasn't nobody up there. It was a private club. It was Caucasian people only. You know, you didn't. It was rare for you to see a brother. The only people be up there is working is us. But I had a brother came to me and say, man, he said, I see you go to work. You have to wear your tuxedo and all the rest. I said, yeah. He said, are they high? I said, yeah. I said, you get your tux. And I talked to the man, and we get you up there. Okay. So they hired him. And this brother here, he's a little thicker than I was, you know. We used to work out, play ball, and all that stuff. And I got him up in there, and I told him, I said, now, what you do? I say, this ain't number by number work. Because he came in the first game, and man, you see that girl over there? I said, man, hey. I said, don't start that. I said, go over there, do your job, leave that alone, forget about that, and come on, bust the table, bring it on back in, put it down so we can get on back and get in and out of here. All right. He goes over there. And he followed my advice, but this woman, undoubtedly, she was mad with her husband, the Caucasian male and a female. And she began to tell him how handsome he was and how well his clothes fit her. And her husband sitting there turning red. And he come back and told me, man, I think that woman liked me. And I said, what? I started watching her. And I seen the dude get up from the table. And I go around the corner, so I follow him around the corner and go in the private office. I listen to the door, but the door's so thick I can't hear. But when you come back, I say, look, this is what we're going to do. I say, I'm going to take you off that table. I'm going to put somebody else on that table. So I switched him around. And I looked around, and later on that night when it was time for us to go home, and I didn't see him. And I said, well, where he at? He said, well, he gone. He out. I said, okay. So next day I come back to work. 2 days pass. I come back to work, and I don't see him no more. And I know it. I'm looking on the schedule. I said, well, no, where he at? I told the man. And the man done hired him. And, but he don't show up for work no more. And I finally went around the corner around there where we played football at. I seen him. I said, man, why you left the job? He said, man, he said, let me tell you something. He said, when I got off that night, I went and I didn't change my clothes. He said, I walked across the bridge with my black pants on and my white shirt. You know, I had to took my bow tie off. And I said, two cops pull up on top of the bridge, had the lights flashing and stuff. And said, both of them got out of the car and started walking across the street with the guns in hand. Come on, I'll come in. We want to talk to you a minute. So he struck out running. Going down the bridge, going down the upcoming section of the bridge, and they in the cars, and so they ran back and jumped in the cars and running. They had to go around to the right side, and by that way he done got away. I said, well, you know they're gonna kill you. I said, why you think they was trying to do it? He said, I know he was trying to do it. He said, that lady husband called him and told him to kill me. I said, So you see what you face. He said, I don't know when work there no more. And I see why every time you be going to work, you be having them guns. I said, well, now you know. I said, that's why I told you, don't go up in there messing with nothing, go do your job, get paid, go home. He said, well, look, I don't want to work there no more. I said, well, I don't pay. That was the incident that was sticking in my mind as well. But what I want to ask you, and I want all the brothers and sisters to be listening to this. I was thinking about this because, in my opinion, anytime a brother or a sister, whoever it is that's gunned down by the police, I think the family of the victim has every right to have the first, middle, and last name of the shooter. What do you think about that?
Say that again.
I think every victim of a police shooting needs to have the first, middle, and last name of the shooter. I think that should be given to them immediately. Because if you if somebody shot your child down, the first thing you want to ask is, okay, well, who shot my child?
They should be given a name. Oh, okay, I got you. They should be told what the name is. No, I definitely agree with that. I agree with that.
First, middle, and last name of the shooter.
What they do is, and again, I mean, I'm not advocating anything, but I'm just talking about realistically. This is what happens. Mm-hmm. They have all kinds of reasons they won't do this. The way that would change, and I'm not advocating it, but I'm saying the way that would change, if when black people were innocent and they were getting killed by people that were perceived to be terrorists and completely unjustified acts of murder in our community, if our people responded very quickly and if they responded quickly and if they didn't care who the name was, what would happen is the police department would take a position where other officers would say, forget that. If somebody shoots somebody, you tell them their name. Because when you don't, all of us catch it. So everybody's got to be responsible. When you shoot somebody, your name got to get out there because I don't want to get shot for your shooting. See, this is what people don't understand. You really want to see the police start looking and finding the terrorist cells within their own midst. All they got to know is it's dangerous not to do it. It's dangerous to allow terrorism to occur in your ranks because it makes you look like a terrorist. And it confuses the community. If they feel that that's the situation, they'll do it themselves. See, we're looking for, and I agree with you. I mean, don't misunderstand. I definitely think it's something that we should request and we should push for and all that. But I'll be honest, most of the stuff that we're looking for as it relates to police come from basic consequences.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if the police is going to lose their job and lose their retirement for doing certain behavior, they're not going to do it. If the police are going to be threatened and be riding around for the next 4 weeks wondering, are they going to make it home that night? The same way the black people that are dealing with terrorists who've infiltrated the police officer are feeling, then they're going to say, you know what? Let's find the bag. They're going to start cleaning it up themselves because who wants to live like that? Just like black people. How is this problem that we face getting fixed? Black people finally say, okay, we can't take this no more. You push people and they'll figure out how to fix stuff. When you start putting pressure on people, Like black people are comfortable with racism and living in the midst of oppression and abuse. Now it's becoming open genocide. Now that it's pushing so hard, black people can't take it no more. And now even the moderate we shall overcome Martin Luther Kinger is now starting to sound more like Malcolm X and saying, I understand why these young men did what they did. I ain't gonna say nothing negative, and I ain't heard no black folks of any importance make any claims of caring about these dead police, really dead. I'm going to say I believe them to be terrorists. Now, I can't say how Micah Xavier Johnson or how Cosmo Setepenra identified and then classified these guys as terrorists, but I'm going to give these brothers the benefit of the doubt. If the police would not have murdered these brothers or killed them, they could have told their story so we would have known how they identified these guys as terrorists. But, of course, you know, a black man doesn't get the same right to a trial that anybody else gets, and these brothers were unfortunately lost their lives. But at least if we don't know anything else, we know that these were good men protecting the black community. And if we have more men like this, this problem's going to end.
Well, I agree with you 100%. And that I think that is very, very important. And I think that if there are policemen listening to this broadcast tonight, I think you should really, really pay attention to what we're discussing here at this particular point. When you have a situation and a policeman shoots one of his citizens down, hurry up and tell who first, middle, and last name of the shooter is. Give that information out. That's very, very important. See, and you know why. You know why. Because you got people inside the United States, they are trained. And they know what to do with the first, middle, and last name.
They know what to do with it. They know how important it is to get that. And that can save a whole lot of stuff and a whole lot of people. But if you're refusing to do that and protecting your body at the expense of your own life, because, and the reason I'm saying this is because the genie is out the bottle. This particular genie ain't going back in the bottle. Bum Hollywood, the genie out the bottle on this one. Because this ain't, you know, we don't see no way. I personally don't see no way in the world that this is going to get better for negotiation, no marching, no protesting, no Black Lives Matter, jumping up and hooping and hollering and shouting in the streets and nothing. We got professionals from one end of the country to the other, and they don't, you know, I always tell people, and I tell people this for a reason. All dogs don't bite. All dogs don't bark. You got some dogs that do not bark. They just bite. I got another caller with his hand raised at area code 347. I'm going to open up the line. Area code 347, you're on the air. Come on in, man. 347, can't hear a word you're saying. Okay. Hold on a minute. Let's see here. Hello?
Yes, somebody. Hello?
I'm listening, man. You're coming across sound like you're kind of breaking up. What's your question or comment for the guest?
I was calling about the getting out of debt with the name change. Hello?
I can hardly make out what you're saying, brother.
Hello?
I hear you now. Come on.
All right. Here's mom. Yeah, I was calling in to listen to the station. I usually just I don't make it to the temple a lot of times, up on 125th Street. But I was calling to listen to the station tonight and listen to you saying I swing you up there to get imitated joint. I mean the genie. And I can't really specify much about, you know, the Black Lives Matter. I know we're not considered black, you know, the indigenous of the land. I wouldn't even really, you know, wow. As I said. We have to first make ourselves aware and conscious of what we are doing. Like, for instance, where I live at, I try to speak to brothers and sisters and all about getting yourself right. I'm not telling you to stop what you're doing, but, you know, do it another way and respecting your brothers and sisters and your mothers and all the people. And they're not ready to do that. So we can't just be mad at the European all the time. And meanwhile, we're hurting each other all the time. No, that's only my point right there. Peace.
Okay, peace, brother.
What's up?
As I was saying about this first, middle, and last name business, that's very, very important. I think that should be given to the family. And I think it because I noticed in a couple of these shootings, and I counted two, where the police captain came out and just said, who was the shooter? First, middle, and last name. He come right out on national news and said it. I said, okay, well, I'm wondering if the people understand the significance of what this police captain had just said, regardless of what anything else that he said, because that's extremely important. But anyway, I don't want to get down into details of that. Everybody got a brain. And but I want to get to this other thing here, Brother Genie, because we dealt with the police precincts in the neighborhood.
Okay.
Do you think it would be helpful if the policeman, the one that's carrying the guns and badges, would be educated in law and not the enforcement of public policy grading in law as law? Do you think that would do something? Do you think that would effect some change?
No.
You don't think so?
Because
there's no lack of understanding that they're murdering black people for no reason. So they're doing it because they can get away with it. They're not doing it because they don't understand something. So helping them understand something, the only thing they need to understand is it won't go without being answered. That is what will change it. Anything else you try to do, some fancy kind of way of trying to intellectualize it, and these are not intellectuals. Police officers are not intellectuals. These are frontline warriors for protecting the community or so-called, whatever you want to call it. But those that are terrorists in the inside, they don't care about any of that. They've already decided they're going to kill black people. So whatever you teach them, it doesn't matter, because all they're going to do is figure out how to do it within the context of what you give them. So, for instance, perfect example of what I'm saying. They've gone a step further than just teaching them law, whatever the case. They put body cams on them to say, we're going to watch and see what you're doing, so we don't have to debate it. Well, what did the police officers do? Well, the terrorists in police uniforms in Baton Rouge, they took the body cams off.
Okay.
So they simply took the body cams and said, look, they said that night, and I wasn't there, but if I was to speculate, what I feel is there are terrorist cells in the police. They operate across different police precincts. I don't know how they organize, but basically they say, hey, we're going to kill black people. I'm assuming most of them are white, but I'm sure they're probably some Asians. And God knows, if you look at that police chief, it might be some black ones. And basically, when they decide to start killing black people, they do it. So there's no law or nothing you can write in there to say, because they just break any rules. Is it? So the law is they can't just go kill a black person. And the law is they got to have a body cam on to show that they're not going out to murder somebody. So they just took the body cam off. Well, there's no rule they can break it because they said it fell off. Well, I mean, there's no way to govern that kind of thing. You're dealing with terrorists. You can't really negotiate with a terrorist or none of that type of stuff. They just have to know that terrorism is dangerous in this area. You know, that's how the United States does it. It's not that people can't commit acts of terror. It's that you're not going to have a bunch of Iraqis coming to America to commit acts of terror because they know what's going to happen. The Iraqis may not have committed the original act of terror, but all my point is they certainly won't be doing it now because of the results of the U.S. saying they committed acts of terrorism. So terrorism has to be met with fierce resistance, and that's what it's going to take to change things.
Mm-hmm. What do you think about the city, states, and counties having contracts between them and the industrial prison complex? You think that need to end?
Oh, man. Okay. Now, if you're talking about something in law that should be absolutely illegal, it should be absolutely illegal to have any investment in any company or in any prison, privatized prison, or any company that has investments in a privatized prison, if you're in any way, shape, or form involved in law enforcement in this country. Because if you have stock in a company that locks black people up, and you also involved in law enforcement or legislation, which determines how long that, first of all, if a black person gets arrested, if they get accused of a crime, and how long they'll get for a crime if they're accused, then you are now in a position where you're fully incentivized to, if black people are committing crimes, to give them longer sentences than they deserve. And if they're not committing crimes, to lie and say that they're committing crimes because you get paid for black people getting locked up. In fact, they had a brother very recently, and I'm not going to lie, he disgusts me to my stomach. But he was leaving his house to go get something from the store for his baby. I mean, his baby.
Uh-huh.
So he just had a baby. He's with the woman and the baby. He goes to the store, and a white officer comes up and says, where's the heroin? Where's the coke? He said, I don't have no coke. What are you talking about? So he makes him pull his pants down and all this stuff. Long story short, he arrests him on cocaine. He throws him in jail. He convinces the jury that this guy had the coke. The brother does 4 years. And all of a sudden, the devil starts feeling bad about what he's done. And he goes around and he tells, hey, look, I lied about this guy and all these people. And his brother, he was just going into the store. I didn't even know him, never seen him before. I didn't see that he did this. And this brother gets out of jail because now the police officer has told what he's done. Well, now this brother's going around with that police officer, and this is his good buddy now. So he disgusts me in that sense. But my point being, so this one European just decided, I'm going to tell what I did. Not, the other 99 out of the 100 are not saying anything. So it's as criminal as anything in the world that they can have a relationship between the privatized prisons and the police and then law enforcement, because it incentivizes locking black people up, which is really a form of enslavement. Really, we're looking at the Atlantic slave trade, where the slave ships are the paddy wagons, and the plantations are the privatized prisons.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I'll tell you what, I look at the situation this way, and I'm going to need you to weigh in on this and give me your opinion. The situation that's happening involving the cops, we got judges that appear to be involved in the same game. You bring them down here regardless of what, we'll give them from now on, or we give them the electric chair, and if you do the same thing, then we'll give you a slap on the wrist. How should the masses view these judges? Because we just had one brother down here. He tried to kill one. He didn't do it right, and he got caught. So how do you view that situation?
Man, I'm going to say it like this.
Now, you don't have to answer that if you don't want to now.
No, I'm going to answer
that. That's kind of rough.
Well, no, I'm going to say it like this. If a judge is making fair assessments of what's going on and doing their job, I do really believe, I'm not going to say white, but I do believe there are judges that try to do what's fair. I really believe that. Now, I'm not going to say the white ones mostly do it. I'm saying there are judges who try to do their job. But if any judge is found to be corrupt, then particularly if it's corrupt in the sense of doing harm to black people, then it will be our responsibility to figure out how to deal with them. Now, I'm not going to sit here and lie. I've never thought about that per se. So that's something I have to give some thought to. But I do know this. I know that if we think about it, and instead of looking for somebody else to do something about it, we take the responsibility of our own to figure out what we're going to do and how we're going to address them, we can come up with a good solution.
Well, I tell you what, I had a situation down here where mm-hmm. we was in this building, and they were getting ready to do some performing and stuff down there in the building. And I had found out that I could go behind the stage and get where I needed to go without walking all the way up around the front and coming all the way back. It was like a short cut. And when I was walking down behind the stage, this guy came out from they had a little bathroom back there. He come out from a little bathroom, and I looked at him, and I remembered him. He's a judge. And I remember when this judge jacked my son around in the courtroom. I mean, this was a real racist judge. But this time, he didn't have the shield of the courtroom. He didn't have no guns and bags. There wasn't nobody standing there but man to man but me and him. And I say, you remember me? I say, don't you remember my so-and-so-and-so, you know, on such-and-such a date when you did so-and-so-and-so-and-so? That cracker struck out running. He was hollering and screaming, help! Help! Help me! He's trying to kill me! He's going to tell me somebody! Help me! And I didn't even get a chance to put no hand on him. Because when he went off on me, I was so shocked, and he struck out running. He was knocking over stuff, running, ricocheting off the wall, running. So when that happened, I went the opposite direction. And next thing I know, the whole back behind the stage, all the police were running behind the stage and stuff, and I walked out in the crowd and stood up in the crowd. And I was looking at him, walking around, looking. I said, man, look at him. Here's a man that know he crooked, done something crooked,
and faced with something, somebody that remembered his crookedness, and he struck out running. It goes back, and I remember what the brothers taught me growing up. They said, whatever you do, do it by yourself, and make sure that if you with somebody, if you find out he's a coward, get rid of him, because a coward will get you killed. Because he sure was a coward. I ain't never seen nothing like that. That man was running. I didn't even know he could run that fast, as old as he was. But boy, look at him. He was getting up. I'd never forget him. And I said, well, boy, I should have shut you up. But anyway, we're down to the last 53 minutes. And, brother, I want to ask you to tell us about the homeschooling and the importance of that and what it is, because I think that we need to be also training our children and our wives and stuff. And, you know, I don't believe in having a woman if she don't know how to shoot. And she tell me, okay, next. You mean, I need to ride and die, you know what I mean? I know. I ain't got time for no kids. But homeschooling, let's weigh in on that. So this is where we get into that.
Well, I think that it is in today's world environment, the reality of it is the whole way we look at the world is we have to have a shift in our mindset. What is important about education is teaching Black people, children, what they're going to need in order to prosper and survive the 21st century. Meaning, Columbus discovered America is not of any value to our children. The basic 12-year lesson plan that they give our people is not of any value. Math is a value. Science is a value. Reading is a value, and history are a value. But not the way history is given to our children. What we need to do is these school environments are trying to turn our children into psychopathic sexual degenerates, a bunch of homophiles, pedophiles, homosexuals, self-hating Negroes, integrationists, individuals prepared to die and commit suicide, which will ultimately be genocide in the 21st century. We need to bring them back into our homes and start saying, wait a minute, instead of training my child to work for someone else, what can they do that's good? What do they do well that they can focus on and become the best at? That is something that Black people need, that can become a career for them, that they don't ever have to go to work for some white folks. And that's a hard thing to do because most of us, even like myself, I never grew up with that economic perspective. I knew I wanted to be an entrepreneur, but I didn't get trained or taught how to do such a thing. It was always about getting a job. You got to try to get a good job and impress somebody. I didn't know about working for yourself and how to do it and how to make ends meet and how to survive on my own. And so it's become a very difficult transition to try to transition into that mindset. I'm still working on it. But if we teach and train our children to do it, they will never ever perceive that they need to get a job. They will grow up with the context or the personality or the idea or the understanding that their job is to produce for themselves. And so if the African world needs warriors, then we need to be homeschooling and teaching our sons how to box, how to fight, how to shoot. We need to not only that, but we need to be teaching them when they're reading their lessons, they need to be reading about Robert F. Williams and Negroes with Guns, Rosa Parks and Brother Nixon down there, them freedom fighters. They need to be reading about H. Rap Brown and Kwame Ture. They need to be reading about the Haitian Revolution. They need to be reading about Fannie Lou Hamer. They need to be reading, and doing reports, but they need to be doing the kind of reports they need to be doing. If they're in psychology, they need to be studying Amos Wilson and Dr. Bobby Wright and Dr. Francis Cress Wells and compare and contrast and say, you know, what did you agree with them on? What did you disagree with them on? What, you know, we need to be challenging our children to think critically and study things critically and come up with their own analysis and thoughts about what they see and things that are relevant to the survival and the upliftment and the prosperity of Black people in the 21st century. as opposed to sitting them in front of our enemies with our enemies preparing them to either service their interests or preparing them for genocide and preparing them for the prison industrial complex. I think that at this point in time, even though I know our people are not in a position to do so, it is all but a crime to send a black child into a public school system.
Mm-hmm. You're absolutely correct. Even Malcolm X said only a fool would allow his enemies to educate his children.
That's right.
In today's society, we keep thinking that our enemies are going to educate us correctly. He won't. He can't. Because he's not going to teach you what you need to know, because if he does, you will take it and you will overthrow him. He can't afford to teach you that. He's only going to teach you what you will need to know to be subservient and never what you really need to know. He won't teach you how to get a job at IBM instead of creating a company that rivals IBM. He doesn't want to teach you who you are, the ancient story, his record, and your ancient record put together and compare it. He doesn't want to teach you about the atrocities and the crimes and murders against you. He doesn't want to teach you that. So therefore, the only thing that we can end up with, and even if we went to Harvard, Cambridge, Yale, and all this stuff, we have guys that will be on CNN spouting the same junk about, well, I'm bipartisan, and what do you think about the Donald Trump campaign and all this crap? Instead of getting out and being productive, we haven't paid attention to the game. No matter who it is that's running for president, they always say something about, well, we got to bring the companies back from overseas and provide more jobs. And then when are you going to tell somebody to go and get a good education and learn how to open up their own company or use their own natural talents to be self-sufficient and independent and own their own company? None of this is ever said. It's always about jobs. It's always about we need to, and we just haven't caught on. And so it's a mess, man. It's really, really a mess. And we still got this thing in our head, well, I'm going to send my kid to college. And, he's going to have this, and he's going to learn this, and he's getting his bachelor's and he's getting his master's, and when the shooting starts, then he's out there. We all need to not provoke any anger, and
that's right.
And you know, we got it. God said and Jesus said, not all this right here foolishness, man. Instead of realizing where you are, what's really going on, and what's happening that's real in the world. This thing is real. It ain't going to get no better. The genie is now officially out the bottle, and he ain't going back in the bottle. It's going to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And
that's right.
So this is how wars start. You know, wars start this way. But you do inside the United States. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask you a question? Because I actually thought it was going 7 to 9 p.m. tonight. I didn't realize it was going 10, but I actually have another call.
Well, if you got to go, I understand, brother.
All right. I apologize for that. I thought it was 7 to 9. That's what they informed me of. I must have got the wrong time.
Okay, give me your last words, and we're going on from here, and I'll close it on down. Let us have it.
All right. Appreciate it. Well, my last words are, first of all, I appreciate the opportunity to come on the program, my brother, and share this information with our people. I think it's important for black people to understand, more than anything, what I can tell people. It is very important that the names Micah Xavier Johnson and Cosmo Setepenra are remembered and revered in a very positive and long-term way. Because the only way we're going to get the kind of manhood that we need to survive the 21st century is to rubber stamp it and show appreciation for it. One thing I've learned as a man, there's nothing more motivating than appreciation from black women for the work that you're doing. The only thing that comes close is appreciation from black children. When your women and children show you appreciation and respect for things that you're doing that are positive, there's no force on earth that will frighten you from continuing to do it, because that adoration and appreciation becomes a badge of honor that you wear consistently on your chest every day and night. So we cannot expect black people to stand up and fight for us if we do not remember them and call their names and Lord praise upon them when they take stances in our defense, regardless of what our enemies think about us doing that. And so ultimately, to be 100% honest, even me, I want to get the opportunity. I really wish there was a way I could do, and I've never done no eulogy or wanted to do one. I don't go to churches, but I wish I could do the eulogy for Brother Micah Xavier Johnson or for Brother Cosmos at Teppenrock, because I can speak words that really give their spirit life, and they can speak to who these men are better than anybody in their family could ever try to do, because they're really in our family, the freedom fighters. These are freedom fighters, and only really a freedom fighter can really speak praise and proper honor to another freedom fighter. So I wish I would, I want to be in a position to be able to do that. In fact, that's what we're going to talk about Monday night. How do we celebrate properly our freedom fighters, those who take life? The sister said earlier, give life. No, I ain't looking for nobody to give life. People getting given life every day, black folk in the God community give their lives. No, people who will take lives in defense of black survival. Those individuals, we need to know how to celebrate them, how to honor them when they go. What kind of ceremony do we do? We can't do the same one we do for a Negro or for a Christian or for a Muslim or for, these are race people. They take lives for our race. We have to give them special salutes when they go. And so I want people just to ponder on that and think about that, because all of us don't have the courage or the heart to go out there and fight the way these men did and put their lives on the lines and risk them in the defense of a future for our people. But all of us should have enough courage to say thank you and to remember them in the best and the highest of lights, and I have nothing but praise and honor for these men every time we speak their names. And with that said, you know, this is not going to be, you know, fixed overnight, but I believe this is the beginning of a very, very positive period in history for African people, where we begin the process of fixing our problems. In conclusion, I'd like to say, for brothers and sisters who are not aware, there is a genocide that is occurring right now with our brothers and sisters in West Papua. And that is in Papua New Guinea in the South Pacific. These are black people who've been there for thousands of years. The Indonesian government is murdering them and butchering and slaughtering them. And we are engaged in an effort to get awareness to this, to help the freedom fighters in West Papua, these black brothers and sisters, prevent their people from being having genocide committed against them. So if you could go to #FreeWestPapua, which is P-A-P-U-A, or go to westpapua.com, freewestpapua.com, or just put Free West Papua in on your Google and look and become familiar with that and send that around on your Facebook, send that around on social media. Let our people know around the world, and particularly in this country, hey, there's a genocide that's occurring right now. We're not talking about yesterday. We're not talking about onesies, twosies, like they're committing genocide in the street with the police with us here. We're talking about they're butchering our people alive, and the pictures are there for you to see what they're doing. We want to get this word out because it's our responsibility to help our brothers and sisters not have what happened to the Native Americans happen to them. So lastly, you can go to waronthehorizon.com. Any of the DVDs that we produce that's talking about black survival in the 21st century are all there in our store. You can get them ordered as email downloads, or you can get them as sent through the mail. So you can go there and order those. And you can also go to waronthehorizon.com, and anytime we have our radio programs live, or you can go listen to the old ones on Blog Talk. We have an icon there that says listen. Just click that icon. It takes you to our Blog Talk station, and you can listen to the live programs or any of the old ones that we've had. So with that said, Brother Tarhaka, we really appreciate your support and your constant bringing us out and letting us share this information with your audience. And we wish you the best, my brother.
All right, my brother. I certainly appreciate you being in here, man. And I thank you. And in the future, I'll be contacting you so we can do some more of this and get this stuff out, man. Thank you.
Fantastic. All right.
All right, Mo. We got 38 minutes. Anybody got a question? Go ahead and raise your hand. I'd be more than happy to answer it. I want to get down into some other little brass tacks around here with this situation because, like I said, the genie is out the bottle. We're in a very, very bad time here inside the United States. And as the brother just said, there's some things that's going on. I wasn't aware of them over in Indonesia and stuff. And because I don't, you know, I try not to watch a whole lot of TV. But when it comes to the shootings and stuff like that, I either use the internet or either I pop it on to see what's going on so that I could make my people aware of what's going on inside the United States. Homeschooling is very, very important. It's important for you, and you've heard me say this over and over and over, every man of African descent inside the United States needs to have a library in his home so that you can point right directly to the facts and lay them on the table. And so your children and your grandchildren and your great-great-grandchildren can learn this information. That's an excellent investment. When it comes to homeschooling and stuff, we definitely need to do this because the educational system inside the United States specializes in miseducation of people that look like me and you. Make no doubt about it. There's no such thing as, well, I'm going to go to Harvard and I'm going to get a master's and a bachelor's and stuff, because by the time you get out of there, you may have your bachelor's and your master's, and you may be involved in this, that, and the other, and have this good paying job and all that. But what about your nation? What about your people? You see, we are all we got. So this is what we need to concentrate on. Okay? Now, I can see if you go in there and get something out of it and still be able to get in there and tell everybody about what you know, about your culture and your story and stuff and you and system, but you discover that you won't last in that long because you're not supposed to have that. You've been designated as a permanent underclass in America. War against you, and it's been declared for hundreds of years, and now it's culminating into a situation now where your back's against the wall, and now you're fighting. So we need to keep this in mind, and don't forget, okay? Just don't forget. Just hold on a second. Hold on. One second.
Please don't tell me this, Lord. Please, Jesus, don't tell me that he's gone.
Hey, boss.
He got pulled over for a busted tail light in the back. And the police, he's covered. They killed my boyfriend. Please don't tell me that he's gone. Please, officer, don't tell me that you just did this to him.
Okay, this is what we have to remember. We have to clearly understand this. The men's out there on the street with the guns and the badges, they're not officers. These are private contractors, just like a plumber, a carpenter, or anybody else. These men are policy enforcers. They're not enforcing the law. The Supreme Court says you have the right to travel, but the cities and the municipalities and uninformed officers that know nothing, uninformed policemen that know nothing about the law, are out on the pavement with guns and badges and forcing you to be involved in public policy, giving up a right for a privilege. This is what's going on. If a man pulls me over and I have a busted taillight, the first question I want to know from him is, what crime have I committed? What crime have I committed? Crime is clearly defined. okay? If we look that up, then we ask ourselves the question based on the evidence that we have. But before I go any further, let me give congratulations to a couple of people. The first is a sister that I heard from this morning. She was spectacular. She was in that courtroom. Of course, she had really beat him a long time ago. But I think it had gotten to the point where she was actually educating. The defense had absolutely nothing to say. They never brought anything to the table at any time. It was totally extraordinary. She beat him down today, and I'd like to say congratulations to the sister. We're going to get on video involving a mortgage and attempted foreclosure, and she did the stomp a buck dance on that. Also, another brother that called me right before I come on the air and told me his little story, how I decided to do them, and they sent it back down to the judge down there and said, hey, fix this. And so he's straightening that all out on a ticket. Got his fee schedule and stuff. They owe him thousands of dollars for violating him. So I want to say congratulations to that brother and sister for what they have done. I would like to say to you, for those of you who have a problem with the foreclosure, if you have a student loan, if you have a child support situation, if somebody's tampering with you, if a bank's trying to do this, that, and the other, go over to www.newdebtelimination.com and look around over there. But before you do anything, call me. Let me know what's going on so I can direct you to what to get. And we are behind you. We do depend on you to actually do the reading and filling in the blanks so that you will know this stuff. And when you know something, you can defend yourself. Our system is not designed to give you all the answers. You just go through the maze, and then after it's all over with, you don't know nothing. That's not learning. That's not accomplishing anything. So if you want to succeed and you really want to do something right, go to newdebtelimination.com. If you got a problem with your foreclosure, student loan situation, regardless of what it is, your freedom of right to travel, getting ticketed and all this kind of stuff, give me a shout, and we'd be more than happy to assist you with your situation. I just wanted to give a shout-out to the two brothers, well, a brother and a sister, and I heard from them today, and I'd like to say congratulations to you. Well done. Well done based on what you've done. So, if you have any questions or comments, you want to weigh on this thing, we're dealing with the police shooting, now you have a voice. The number to dial in is 310-982-4184. Press 1 on your phone, open up your phone line. You can let me know what you got to say. Okay? Commercial break, and when I come back, we'll be ready to finish off the broadcast. Okay? Y'all hold on a minute.
Okay, everybody, listen up. If you have been served with papers for foreclosure, or if you are already in court fighting foreclosure, call Tarhaka Amana L. Bay at area code 904-303-9061 for the foreclosure killer. You can visit our website at www.newdebtelimination.com. You don't have to lose your home. Call Tarhaka. 904-303-9061 before 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Stop foreclosure dead in its tracks. Okay?
Okay, now let's answer some of the questions that we got here. Is it wrong for our people to defend themselves in the street by any means necessary? The answer to that question, absolutely not. When approached by a man with a gun in the street, should we be prepared to kill that man? The answer is absolutely yes. When a man shoots at another man, should the man who was shot at shoot back? Yes. Okay? I want to make this perfectly clear. All right? Now, I'm not, you know, I mean, these questions are the easiest question that you can possibly answer for yourself. and they were put together that way so that you can realize that you are not dealing with something that you can't deal with. If it bleeds, you can kill it. War has been declared against you, and you have to, what I would recommend that you do is look up war. Look at what is absolutely all about, because there are a lot of people inside the United States. We feel like we've been on one end looking at war from everywhere else. War in Russia, war in China, war in Korea, war in Japan, and we're sitting comfortably in our chairs and looking at war involving somebody else, a disaster that happened someplace else. And we feel like, well, it didn't get us, so I can just still remain calm and stuff. But things have changed now. We're in a terrible situation because war have been declared on us and our children. So there's a whole different posture that we're going to have to take involving this situation. We're going to have to get real with it. We're going to have to realize that this is real. I also want to add that we need to start, and I know you've heard me say this before, but we're going to have to get our own body camera. I mean, we got cell phones and all that's good, but we need our own body cameras. They got little spy shops and stuff right there on the internet. You can type it in. They got necklaces with cameras and audio in. They got sunglasses with cameras and audio attached to it. They got belts. They got bracelets. They got watches where this information can be recorded. It can be downloaded and upgraded, uploaded to your computer. There's also software that's available where whenever there's an incident that's occurring that's being recorded, that information can be transferred automatically to a separate computer in a different location. Anytime you are approached by someone from behind you, headlights come up indicating that you stopped. You must immediately begin to record. Immediately begin to record. Cut on the recorders. Make sure that you got your dash cam in the back, dash cam in the front, dash cam in the passenger door. If you got a dash cam on your watch, make sure your audio is in place. And make sure that this stuff is operational. And you want to make sure that you have someone on the phone with you listening to the whole situation anytime you stop. This is the position that we're in inside the United States. If you're jogging, a lot of times sisters and brothers get up early in the morning and jogging down the street. Get your body cam on. Make sure you got your body cam. If you got binoculars, a small set of binoculars, make sure you got that. With you, hang them around you so that you can see, and make sure that you have a notepad and pencil or pen with you so that you can write information down, okay? And make sure you have this information available to you. And it's really sad that we have gotten to this point, but all of this provides protection for you. Because I remember when I was growing up, we had a situation where we would play ball in the street. Sometimes we'll play baseball, sometimes we'll play football, or we just play catch with one another. And the men that raised me, they always told me, anytime you go out there, make sure you got a situation where somebody is hit by a car. You can write down the tag number, you can write down a description of the individual, the color of the car, and all of this information is recorded. If there's some kind of markings or numbers on the car, you can write that down. That's very, very important for you to have that information. If you're out jogging, you want to make sure that you have these tools available. You got your phone. You got your body cam on you. For policemen to have the body cams, as if we got body cams, that'll make it better for everybody now. No, we got our own body cams too, okay? We got everything that we need. We got our own binoculars. That's very important so you can see things from a distance. Okay, if you're recording
something on your phone, or if you see your brothers and sisters being beaten down in the street, or if they're being attacked, record the information. Get it recorded. Find out who the victim is. Get that information to them so that they can use that information. My guest is gone. I think we've done enough damage here tonight. Keep in mind, tomorrow night we'll have the Grand National Chairman for the Moorish government. They will be available. And so I want you to make sure that you tune into that broadcast. And on the 31st of this month, make sure you tune in to me and Dr. Walter Williams and his wife. We'll have a round table discussion. There'll be several other people on this discussion line. We will be discussing racism in America, and we'll be discussing racism worldwide in the history of racism. So make sure that you tune into that broadcast. Okay? Got a lot of work to do. I certainly appreciate y'all being here this evening. And I'm going to go ahead and close this thing down early because I've been working all day. And I'm going to make sure that I get cracking on the next broadcast for tomorrow night. Okay? I've been your host, Tarhaka Monte L. Bay. And until next time, y'all have a nice evening.
In hot down Mississippi, surrounded by four walls that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. Best believe.
Thanks a lot. Wow. New York, just like I pictured it. Skyscrapers and everything.
Hey, brother. Hey, come here, Slick. Hey,
huh?
you look hip, man.
Hey, you want to make yourself $5,
man? Yeah,
bro. Hey, look here. Run this
time.
Speed for me, right quick, okay?
Run this time.
What?
Huh?
I don't know.
Give me a minute.
What? I'm just
going to
walk the street.
Drag him out.
Pause, no.
What'd I
do?
Turn around.
Put your hands behind your back. Let's go.
The jury of
your
peers having found you guilty 10 years.
What? Come on. Come on,
get in that cell, nigga.
God, Lord.